you got to stick through this one. Brynn Arens joins us, and this is Everywhere, All Over the Place, Psycho Babble, as I teased you guys. This is Psycho Babble about Bill, about Eddie Kramer, about Ace Frehley, about KISS. There's just so much stuff everywhere. Stick through it. I know it's long, it's crazy, it's fun.
Sit down with a bowl of popcorn and be ready for 2 solid hours of madness.
Hey everybody, welcome to another episode of Three Sides of the Coin. We've actually got a third side of the coin. Here's a quick question. Do you guys know that there really are three sides to a coin?
Well, yeah, heads, tails, and the edge.
There you go. Tommy's smart. I remember when I first named the show, people were like, what are you doing? There's two sides on a coin. I'm like, don't think about it.
I always thought it was cool that you picked potentially the worst KISS song ever to make it your title.
Oh, I don't know. There's a lot worse than that.
Yeah, wait, let's go through them. I Love It Loud, Love Theme from KISS.
Burn, Bitch, Burn.
Log in the Fire, yeah.
Love Theme's awesome. What other one did you say, Tommy?
I Love It Loud.
It's a great song.
I Still Love You.
Garbage.
Three Sides of the Coin. Choose one.
Hey,
we can't do that.
We have to pick an Ace song because we're big Ace fans.
Who is it?
Yeah, they all think we're haters.
All right, so I'm one of your co-hosts.
I toured with Ace in the 90s.
Well, we got to tell people who you are, so just one minute here.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Reel it in.
I'm a hungry baby bird.
Among other things.
This guy on one side over somewhere is Tommy Summers. I'm Michael Branville. Tommy, do you want to introduce this psycho babble that's going on in the other window?
Absolutely.
Over analytical psycho babble.
This is a very good friend of mine and Mike's of the show, too. This is Mr. Brynn Arens. He is the lead singer of the Oddfathers. He was the lead singer of Flip. He's been in Funhouse, Obsession, and God knows how many other bands. He's from the Minneapolis area. He is a music icon in Minnesota, and his bands have gone national. His new project, I have been behind 100%. Mike, you too. We love it. The Oddfathers, you guys got to go check it out. So the reason that we have Brynn sitting in as a guest host today is because Brynn has a lot of history with the band. Not only is he a fan from the way back years, he also worked with Bill Aucoin for over 20 years. So we thought it would be a great thing to get Brynn on the show. He was kind enough to give us some of his time today so we could just kind of talk about things that he's done. Oh, and he also owns Rocksteady, by the way. So if you guys want to order a Rocksteady t-shirt, we'll get you hooked up.
Stop. No.
Well, you better be doing it now because, listen, yeah, we can sell three sides t-shirts. You want to put some Rocksteady shirts in our store?
Yeah, the cat's out of the bag.
Okay, whatever you guys want to do, I'm fine either way.
We want to sell Rocksteady t-shirts.
So this week is kind of a special guest slash friend joining us because we always thought we would have some friends just sit in as well. So Brynn kind of falls into both sides of that coin.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, see, you are the
third.
That's
normally where I'd segue into how bad that song is, but I think we already covered that, right?
Yes, we did.
That was a segue setup. By the way, this is really fun, and I'm like playing the staring game with both of you guys. You just don't know it. I'm playing the blinking game, and in my mind, every time one of you guys blink, I say to myself, I won.
All right, let's all take our glasses off and just blink.
My eyes go goofy when I take them off.
So for the three of you that are still tuned in, let's get going on this.
Exactly. I'm sure this show is going to piss off some of our viewers.
I'm sorry. I'm not good at this.
Yeah, you are.
So guys, we're recording this on Friday, April 4th. Last night, KISS did this rare acoustic show at a casino/bingo hall. It truly was a bingo hall that they were playing in.
Cool.
At a casino, it's their bingo room that KISS set up. Apparently, the acoustics in a bingo room are not that great. Go figure.
And why that location of all the places in America? Why that place?
Well, I'm sure, one, it was very close to where all four of those guys live and crew and everybody else. So it was, you don't need hotel rooms. It's easy to get in and out. It's a casino.
And it was available. Those things are just happen for a million reasons.
Casinos other than, pay well.
Other than, yeah.
Yeah. So anyway, they did an acoustic storyteller type of show. And before I get into what I want to comment on, let me just read the set list that was shared with us by Joey Middleton shared this set list for us. So remember, this is all acoustic. They started with Coming Home, Dr. Love, Hard Luck Woman, Christine 16, Hide Your Heart, Going Blind, Cold Gin, Do You Love Me, Nothing to Lose, Love Her All I Can, A World Without Heroes, Plaster Caster, Take Me, See You Tonight, Rock Bottom, You Shook Me. Then they did Mississippi Queen. They did kind of a Led Zeppelin mountain medley song, medley there. Got to Choose, Shout It Out Loud, and Rock and Roll All Night.
You know, that's funny you say that they did, to me, that they did Mississippi Queen. If I had the opportunity to produce KISS, one of the ideas I'd bring up would be influences, like have them do a Humble Pie song, have them do a song by The Move, have them each pick like a few of their favorites, and do a friggin' cool covers record.
Well, yeah, wasn't it in Nothing to Lose where Gene says that Mountain was one of his all-time favorite songs? I can't remember which song it was. Maybe it was
Nantucket Sleigh Ride, probably. It's something. A lot of people. Yeah. Very influential band. And, Leslie West, the guitar player, certainly one of the architects of the big rock guitar sound.
Are you guys impressed with that set list?
I am.
Me too. I loved it.
Yeah.
The only thing, right away, though, you can't, excuse me, I just had a big plate of pasta. You can't help but, you hear Hard Luck Woman, and I'm like, who's singing that? That's like, okay, here, we're going to do Making Love, but we're going to take one of the guitars away. And I don't get it.
I'm just happy they're doing something different. And my question would be is, why can they play Coming Home acoustically, but they can't add it to their regular set in a concert?
Because this is a different audience in their mind. I'm quite sure they're the only people that are... This is like the cruise. The only people that come out to this are going to be the hardcore fans. That's
yeah.
what they think.
Yeah, and I think they keep the song, as a special thing for when they do acoustic things, so they don't, they save it for the acoustic show type setting.
So one of the other things was, this was supposed to be...
What's that movie? I don't get it. I don't get it. What movie is that?
Oh, no.
I'm sorry.
Okay, guys, hang in there.
Tommy, your job is to control Brynn.
It's impossible. And just for you listeners, Brynn and I are on the phone almost every day up until the last couple of weeks in the morning. He calls me at 7:30 in the morning after about three cups of coffee, and it starts in on me, gets my day going. So just go along for the ride, guys. There's going to be some great information.
Does he call your house and get your wife and go, hi, is Tommy there? Can I talk to Tommy, please?
No, he calls me on my cell phone because I'm usually already at work, but he would do that. But his wife, Susie's like, oh, are you talking to Tommy again?
All good.
It is.
There's something going on here.
I mean, it's, huh?
There's something going on here.
Oh, no question.
Oh, you're killing me.
All right, guys. So one of the things, this was supposed to be like a telling stories between the songs.
Yeah.
And one of our listeners, Renee Rodriguez, went to this. Renee is a big fan. And I had asked him, I go, nobody's really detailed the stories portion of the show because... Frankly, that interests me more than the set list. I would love to hear what the stories were between the songs. What did they say? What did they talk about? And here's what Renee came back and said. He goes, Paul started off trying to talk about how the songs were written, but it quickly stopped. I couldn't really make out what he was saying in some spots, and he tried to get Gene involved, and Gene was in, quote, asshole mode, and would give one-word answers. So it went from Paul describing how he had a notebook of song titles, and that one day Gene opened his notebook, stole a song title, and it ended up being Christine 16, to, this song is off Destroyer, 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 Destroyer! So Paul just gave up and introduced the songs like that by the middle of the show. So that kind of, I don't know, to me that would have been the real jewel of this show, is even that one thing where he said, yeah, Gene opened up my notebook of ideas, stole a song title, and it ended up as Christine 16. That's what I want to hear more than playing Christine 16.
Right. Well, it's like that Eagles show that they're doing the history of. They tell stories between the songs. I would love to see KISS do that.
You know, maybe, and here's what I replied back to Renee. I go, maybe they should have actually rehearsed the conversation and not the songs.
Yeah.
Perfect.
Here's a song called Christine 16 that Gene stole from my notebook. Or here's the song, you know, da 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 da. Now here's the song we're going to play tomorrow and tonight. I don't know if they could do that, if they'd have to play the song they were talking about.
Well,
now,
you know, maybe they could use
sit there going, why didn't they play the song that they were just talking about?
Maybe they could Alzheimer's. use the teleprompters to feed them the conversation.
Yeah.
Dude, what's on your finger?
What?
That's what I was thinking.
Actually, you want to know what it is? You know I love your guys' show so much, right?
Is that and Vaseline?
Actually, well, I am so excited to be on the show that since we've started, just before the Skype came up and stuff, I've had my right hand down my pants the whole time. But not the front. What?
So it's a scab?
It's a scab.
All right, so let's, okay, so I agree with you. You know, I would love to have heard all of the stories, but I suppose it's got to be more than just one person telling them.
Well, yeah, it sounds like Gene checked out, and Paul didn't want to continue doing the whole thing.
Well, because, yeah, you'd like some help, I suppose.
You'd like the help of the primary songwriter in your band to jump in and tell the stories with you.
I bet they were fighting about something else, and that was one of the band members' basic negotiation tactics about some other completely unrelated situation within the band.
There you go.
Do they do that?
Everybody does that. You do that at work. Everybody does that everywhere.
Okay, so let's dive into this, all right? Because this is one.
I'm doing it right now.
Well, I know, but I want to take you a little further, my friend. I want to talk about why you think it's so hard for them to work out this whole thing with the Hall of Fame. Why can't the four of them? Because people want to know this. From your experience in bands, if you had to guess, what do you think is going on?
Oh, God. I gotta think, it's really hard. It's a weird situation, KISS, with this Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. The thing that stands out most in my mind is how the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame tried for business and political reasons from past things to keep KISS out of it. But at the same time, there are so many bands in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame that were so obviously influenced by KISS, but they're not even rock bands, like Patti LaBelle. Actually, I don't know if LaBelle is in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame, but
probably is.
Yeah, and Parliament, and bands that don't really, that have nothing to do with rock and roll per se, who totally copped KISS's live show in a million other musical genres. Every genre stole from KISS, but they're actually the rock band that does that stuff. Absolutely. That's
I want to know why the four of them can't get along long enough to do a performance.
Why the band members can't get along
Maybe long. They just truly don't like each other.
Well, here's my take. Oh, God. Here's my take on it. Without Gene and Paul, there would be no KISS. Okay?
That's fair.
Ace and Peter, as awesome as they are and as important as we know they are artistically to the core of what us, the KISS audience, gets to see and hear, is optimum KISS. No two ways about it. But the truth is, on a behind-the-scenes business level, on a million levels and a million little things, Ace and Peter were literally weights around their neck. Gene and Paul made KISS happen and kept KISS happening in spite of the other band members, in spite of Vinnie Vincent.
Okay, so I've got a follow-up question for that, but I want to throw just a little tidbit in here related to the Hall of Fame.
But I still think Ace, I want to say that I still think Ace and Peter deserve to be in the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame without question.
Oh, absolutely. Without
question. You're asking me where the animosity comes from. That's where I think the animosity comes from.
So I just mentioned this to Tommy this morning. I'm betting that KISS performs at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame next week. I don't know what version of KISS, but I bet they do. Only because as the crazy KISS fan, I'm going to read into one post that I saw online. It was tweeted and it was posted to Facebook. Eric Singer's drum tech said, "Next stop, New York City."
Yeah.
Why would a drum tech? Now, he didn't say he's going to New York City, so I'm reading into it. I'm just being the psycho KISS fan, and believe me, other fans have already picked up on it and are reading into it on the FAQ big time. But If it was only four guys going out there to accept an award and not play, you don't bring your techs. Is that a fair assumption? You're a fan.
Yeah, unless he's also a tech/assistant. I mean, unless he works with Eric Singer in other facilities other than just ones that require a drum set.
Like what, helping him get dressed?
No, like to and fro meetings, driving. I mean,
I just got to imagine. No, I have no insight into what this guy does beyond being the tech. But you're not gonna pay for a tech to go
probably
to New York
not.
City.
That's the only reason I can think of. You know, or is the guy from New York and
no.
He's going there at the same time to visit?
No, he's from the West Coast.
Okay.
Well, maybe the hall is starting to cave because it sounds like there's a lot of unsold tickets.
Carnegie Deli cheesecake, that's why.
I don't know. I'm just, you know, it's time to put our bets out there. Do you think they're going to play? Don't you? I think they still will. I think they're going to pull one of these. We're going to shock you. We at the last minute felt like we needed to do this for the fans. We could all make up the PR speak that's going to come out of the mouths of Gene and Paul.
You know, if they had a problem with the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame with them performing there and stuff, I don't understand why they just can't book a venue near it and do it right after.
Madison Square Garden.
Do it exactly how they want and make it the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame induction celebration. There you go, Doc. Marketing 101 for you.
I don't know. I just found that interesting. And like I said, fans picked up on it right away on the KISS FAQ board. There was a whole thread where they were already looking into it. I was just like, well, that's kind of interesting. Well, you know,
that is be awesome.
Anything's possible at this
it's
point.
Interesting to come.
What do you guys think? Putting your bets on it, are they going to play or are they not going to play?
My bet would say they are not going to play.
Okay.
It's a matter of not about letting people in, leaving people out. It's too tough.
Yeah, I guess I would have to lean towards your side on that one too and just say I don't think it's going to happen either, because we're getting really close. Not that there wouldn't be a surprise, but it just seems to me like there's too big of a division.
God, it's fun to contemplate how they would do it. What would be cool and what would work is if they did it in, you know, like if the original band came out and did a song right? And then they moved to the next version. If they did it chronologically with everybody, but then we run into the problem of this, don't we? Vinnie Vincent at some
point. Oh, I thought it was Live Long and Prosper.
Yeah, that's a buck, you all. You said it.
Damn.
Actually, two. So, yeah, I don't think they'll do it. I don't. So that'll be a good homework question, too. Ask people what they think.
Well, I posted that this morning on our Facebook page.
Are you kidding?
Oh, you did? Okay.
I said it's time to place your bets. We're 1 week. A week from today, we will know what happened.
Yep.
Yeah, that's true. We will.
How many dates is it? I like the countdown stuff I've been seeing and people posting old pictures and stuff. Well, how many days away are we?
It's seven.
Yeah, next Thursday.
Next Thursday.
That's my birthday.
It is?
April 7th. Born 4761, baby.
No, not April 7th.
Oh.
7 days.
What'd you say?
Tommy. April 10th.
That's the 10th. So we'll go to Matt's. We'll celebrate your birthday. I'll get a candle in one of the burgers for you.
All right. So Brynn, so what I wanted to ask you, though, is, so in all of the years you spent with Bill Aucoin, did you ever talk to him about the animosity between Gene and Paul and Ace and Peter? Was there ever any discussions?
Nope.
Well, that makes this show pretty boring.
The one thing he's made clear, and he's made it clear enough. What's that?
I said that makes this show pretty boring.
Well, the only thing he's said it before. Well, what can I tell you? Ace and Peter were true rock and rollers, and Paul is a true musical guy, and Gene just really wasn't a rock and roller. So the real division was there, and he meant that in attitude, not so much in musical notes. But the attitude certainly translates to the musical notes. But yeah, that, you know, there was always a division from day one.
So from day one, Bill thought there was a clear division going on.
Oh, absolutely. No question.
Because we hear from people who, like, early on felt like there was a all-for-one, one-for-all team early on when they just formed, and that it was over time, 75, 76 divisions started to really happen.
Well, it is. I mean, you got meat and potatoes on one plate, right? So, I mean, they were definitely two separate things doing the same thing, but yeah. But there was definitely a cut. But no, he never really talked about animosity.
So what did he talk about? What did he talk about that you as a KISS geek were like, this is freaking cool?
Oh, I can't. God, the one that springs right to my mind, I can't even say it.
Come on, sure you can. It'll give us a lot of views.
We didn't really talk. I do remember once we were out in some hotel in Hollywood, and I was doing a record with Art Alexakis from Everclear, and me and Bill and Art were out in by the pool, and I started asking Bill, like, Bill was having some drinks. I was having some drinks. Art did not drink. And I started asking Bill, like, what his favorite KISS album was, Beth or Flaming Youth and stuff like that. Like,
setting him up.
And he had come up with an answer, too. Oh, Beth, for sure. Whichever one did the best business was his answer. But I called them albums. You know, he didn't know one record or one album from the next, one song from the next, as far as, like, musical content goes.
Because he was the business side.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and we had Roman on, as you know, a couple of weeks ago to kind of talk about Bill. You what?
I watched it. It was awesome. I love Roman.
Well, and you know, yeah, you're friends with Roman.
You know, you had a personal shout out from Roman during that show.
Yeah, you did.
It was awesome. I did.
Yes. Well, so then tell the viewers a little bit about what it was like to work with Bill. So,
well, let's go back. How did you connect with Bill Aucoin to begin with at the very start? You just blindly email him or
I was
him?
In a band called Funhouse, and we were managed by a guy named Herb Gart, guy I still do work with. Awesome guy, Herb Gart, managed Bill Cosby, Don McLean, Janice Ian, da-da-da-da, 60s guy. Got a great story about me and Herb and Mick Ronson and Prince. If you want to hear it, remind me. Anyway,
you got to tell that.
Anyway, Bill was brought in by Herb to check out our band. I was the rhythm guitar player. We had a lead guitar player, lead singer, drummer. And Bill told Herb, my manager, that you should get rid of the lead singer and the lead guitar player, and I should front the band because I was kind of like monkey boy on stage, just all over the place and stuff. And this would have been like 1985. And I wasn't comfortable doing that. I wanted an all-for-one band. I stuck in for the band, you know, and not only that, I was scared shitless to even begin. I didn't even sing backup vocals. So anyway, that's how we met. At the end of that night, we ended up playing a game called Cardinal Puff Puff. You familiar with this game?
Nope.
Here's the drinking game. Here's the Cardinal Puff for the first time tonight. You drink a beer, and then it's the next guy's turn, and then every time it goes around, you got to say it twice and drink twice and say it three times. One of those silly games, right? That night, Bill, me and him played Cardinal Puff for like 5 hours. It was fun. But that's how we met, was then.
So then after that, fast forward to what ended up happening or how you hooked up with him for the Flip project.
Well, then later on, I was hired by RCA Records to write songs for a group called Kick Tracy and a lead singer named Steven Chereau. Still great friend of mine, and me and him still do songs together and write together and jam together. Anyway, that band fell apart. And one of the things that I had written and recorded and produced for them was a cover of My Generation that Steven didn't have time to sing on. So I ended up singing on it. And at the same time, my friend of mine who owns a light company had just bought a bunch of new lights. And he filmed us doing this version of My Generation. I took it back to New York with me where I lived at the time, showed a few people. And my phone went kabuki crazy, and I was getting offers to make records from every record company more than once, you know? And, I'm like, oh my God, Bill Aucoin, he was right. So that's when I called him. I figured Bill must be the guy for this then.
So when you called him, did Bill,
that would have been 1993 or 94. 94, 95. I had worked with a couple other people prior that, but then went to Bill.
So when you called Bill up, did he like, yeah, I want to work with you. I want to manage you. I want to get you a record deal in the next month or our deal's over type of thing?
No, because I already had the record deal.
You just brought him in to manage.
He didn't get me the record deal.
So the record deal was for you as a solo, as an individual artist?
Nope, it was as for Flip as a group.
Okay.
Yep. But so I mean, it was my, you know, without appearing the asshole and anybody that was in the band or worked with the band would tell, I mean, it was my, I was the leader of the group.
Right. So yeah. So for those, and I think people need to go check out Flip online.
Yeah,
because you need to understand the band's visuals, the attitude, the stage presence. Were you guys that?
And you might want to listen to our hit, the one that was a hit called "Freak." You might want to listen to that, and then after that, you might want to listen to Paul's version on their record
on Monster.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It was submitted for that song. Was submitted for that record.
Really.
Really. Listen to the content.
Interesting.
But, look, you know,
Tommy, you're nodding your head like you've known this all along and you've never shared this bit of minutia.
Well, you know, I got to tell you, I don't know what's important to somebody else to some. I don't, you know, I've been doing this professionally since 1969. To be honest with you, sometimes I say things and people go, why didn't you ever tell me that before? And I'm like, I don't know. I didn't think it was of interest because to me, it's the same thing as, you know, setting up a photo shoot, all the millions, other things. I don't know any better.
Oh no, I totally get it. I mean, we're close, too close to this so many times that it's part of our day in and day out business. That yeah. You know, I tell my clients, I'm like, you know, what's trash to you is gold to your fans.
Right.
And it's true.
And it's so true. So that little bit of nugget of, well, where did the song Freak, the whole story behind it? So you...
Paul Stanley stole my song, but I am saying if Paul Stanley were to have lifted some of my song, I mean, God, I've stole enough from him over the years. I think I still owe him money.
So, did somebody reach out to you and say, Brynn, do you have something you could submit? Or did you just say, hey, let me send this over?
No.
How did it work?
I happen to be doing stuff by request with Bob Ezrin at that time for Alice Cooper album. So I was sending his stuff.
My Nightmare sequel? Two, yeah.
I have a good story about that, too. I didn't believe how I got a certain vocal effect. Anyway, my little brother, Kai, who sings on Monster, told me about the record. So no, I just went to their websites and sent it.
So you sent it to McGee, or did you send it?
No, I sent it to Paul's and to jeans.com's. And I'm sure, I know they're aware of me on some level. It's just uncomfortable.
So then what happened? Did somebody contact you?
No, I heard the song.
Oh, so at that, it was just, wow, that's, I heard the song. This sounds pretty cool.
Yeah, this Freak song. I like this. I remember my school teacher.
Did you get a free copy of the album at least?
She used to say I was a high school creature. No.
See, and we talk about so much different stuff. That this is just one of the many. There's hours of this.
So I have to go listen to both versions of Freak. I've got all of the Flip albums. I loved Flip. Loved them.
They were a great band.
Anyway, where I was getting with, listeners, you got to go check out Flip because you can see that these guys were KISS fans.
Oh, yeah.
And you wore makeup.
That's not KISS related. That's from a band where I grew up called Diamond, Johnny Johnson, in North St. Paul on 3rd Avenue down on Margaret. You know where I'm talking about. Mm-hmm. Anyway, when I was in grade school, he was the band. And at that time, there was hardly even one band in every town, let alone how it is now. There's three bands in every household. So it was really an interesting thing. And I used to go see Diamond play. He was high school age. I was grade school age. And he did it. And I think he got it from Star Trek.
Well,
That guy.
Yeah.
Yeah, I remember that episode. Because
your makeup was basically black and white. It was a 50-50 black. It wasn't like a character makeup. But you guys each had basically individual personas / characters that you, it's not like you all dressed together. You were uniquely different people. You can definitely, I mean, as a KISS fan, you would either go, wow, these guys are KISS influenced, or I like this because I am a KISS fan. This is theatric. I mean, you were a theatric band.
Oh, very.
And the songs were had all, well, the songs had a hook. They're catchy. That's the other piece.
And the
bass player, Randy Freaky, he's in Hairball now. Hairball, if you guys remember, was the band who opened for KISS or for
in
the
Vegas.
Alice Cooper thing. Yeah, and did all of that. So there's all these things that tie together.
He was in heaven that day.
So anyway, you start working with Bill Aucoin with Flip. How much did you bring to the table in that Flip was already set up with this, the visuals, the theatrics, the characters, or did Bill sit down and go, you know what, you got something here, but let's turn it up to 11?
Bill's not what I would call an inventor. Bill is a watcher who, as silly as it sounds, and to say it in this way doesn't give it the credit it deserves because it's much harder than it sounds, but he sees something that you do and he tells you it's good and he helps you bring it out. Bill might have the idea of, hey, try the blue shoes, you know, the metaphorical blue shoes. Let's try this. But that's really, that don't come from him much. The idea really doesn't come from him. What comes from him is how to make that idea breathe and live. And I don't mean on a financial level. I mean on a creative level, on how to make it make sense. For instance, when I was the musical director for The Who's Broadway production of Quadrophenia. They needed an assistant director to help the group perform and stuff. And I had them hire Bill right away, and he was perfect for it.
So in the, it sounds like from what you just said, in the Bill Aucoin, Sean Delaney relationship,
oh, yeah.
Sean is the guy who came up with the crazy ideas.
Yep.
Sean would have been the guy who looked at Flip and said, you know what? You need to put a rocket pack on your back and it needs to shoot, you know, foam out or something like that.
Well, I did that stuff with Sean, did it through me, you know, heavy influence for sure. But Bill would be the guy who would say, no, that sucks, or yeah, that's great. And he would really encourage it. I mean, encouragement in given in the right way in that kind of situation is just everything. And especially if you're working with rock bands who generally tend to be people with low self-esteem. So that kind of push and doing it in the right way was one of his many talents, for sure. And Roman said that. Roman said, you know, he was a feel-good guy, people loved him, and he was a forward thinker and a forward mover. And he was always did it with a smile on his face. I would pick him up from the airport and bring him to my house first thing. He loved to just hang out with my mom, dad, and shit. He loved it.
Would you guys like play KISS records and look at your magazines?
Yeah, my dad would say, God, Brynn, I was concerned about you as a child when you were collecting all this KISS stuff, and now you come home with their manager. I should have said something back then.
I would have thought he would have said, all right, I'm putting a stop to this collecting of KISS stuff.
This KISS collecting has got to stop.
Because you just brought home the manager. You can't have the manager in your collection.
Well, you will sit right here between the box and the radio. Not so much in this area here. Just a little bit more over. Not just right in that. Yeah.
Lord.
I still talk to Bill. I with this new group, the Oddfathers, whenever something comes up that I need to think about, it's our first thing literally is what would Bill do?
I was
literally.
Just going to say, do you have one of those things where
everybody and their brother, dude, I mean, everybody, name them. I failed on them.
What would Bill Aucoin say if we wanted to do this?
I think
his first thing he would say is, do you like it? Yeah, I think it's really fun. Why do you think it's fun? Because this is cool, do it. That would be it. That would be Bill.
So I guess, you know, so we talked to Roman about Bill the person. And I want to get from you, Bill the businessman.
Oh.
You know, what was he like in cutting deals and making arrangements and bringing people in? I mean, as a manager, what was he doing?
Well, the Flip thing, he got us a couple more deals, hence the Rocksteady Records. But one of them was with Artemis Records, hence why I was working with Art Alexakis. Danny Goldberg, who was, you know, the early KISS publicist,
right.
And Zeppelin and stuff, was the president of the company. So that relationship was still healthy, and I certainly remember being in a few meetings with those guys, and it was great. As far as, like, Bill's business, he's really about – it's hard to say because you have to create a situation and come up with an answer. I can tell you this. We were on tour with Evanescence. Evanescence was just breaking, right? And Flip had a hard time keeping an agent. People loved working with us because we'd do this crazy shit, like have pillow fights on stage at the end of the set. Now, when I say pillow fights, we would also hire a helicopter to drop 50, just tons of this shit, right? Cereal and stuff like that. So we kept losing agents because promoters would get bummed out, right? We'd steal all the newspaper and everything, but promoters were getting bummed out. So we get this tour with Evanescence.
Now, were they getting bummed out? Why? Because you were doing stuff that was costing them money, that it was...
unnecessary work.
Yeah, they didn't want to deal with it.
Setting up a concert, you know, set up a party at your house, and the guy who's trying to be noticed the most decides to break open a feather pillow, you know?
Got it.
Somebody's got to clean it up. So anyway, we got done with the first show with Evanescence in St. Louis, and we're going into our tour bus, and I'm walking right in front of my tour manager, Sean Walgren, and he gets cold cocked, bam, in the back of the head, bam, falls on me, and like turns around, and then I see, bam, guy fucking kicks him, right? It's Evanescence's tour manager because of the feather pillow fight. And we had leaf blowers and vacuums with us. Our guys would clean it all up afterwards. But the band Evanescence didn't like how much the audience liked it because it was awesome. And we got a call about 10 minutes later. Bill was there, and me and Bill were in the back of the bus. And Bill's just laughing it off. He hardly don't even care. He just thinks it's funny, you know. Get a call from the agent literally 20 minutes later saying that he's got to drop the band, you know. Evanescence called, and you got to get this band up.
It sounds like something Bill went through with KISS.
Well, and all of a sudden, you know, there's this slight panic, feeling of panic amongst the band members, and they're all kind of behind me. And I look at Bill, and he's on the phone with this guy, and he goes, "Well, you said you wanted a fucking rock band. Okay, talk to you later." And that was it. And I just stood there and turned around and looked at my band and went, "Fucking right."
You guys are I saw one flip show in San Francisco where you were touring with Everclear.
Yeah, I remember when you came out.
I came out, and I was just like, I was floored. I mean, it was one of those, these guys are just crazy.
If only crazy. The guy could sing. Missed it by this much. Another brush with greatness.
I wasn't paying attention to whether you could sing or play. It was all about the cool costumes and all the effects. And
absolutely.
And I was just like, these guys are an opening band and they're doing all this stuff. I mean,
I have a good way of, like, when you're the opening band, you're really limited to the amount of production you can have on, you know, use of their production.
Right.
But there's nothing that says you can't turn your amps into light trees.
Right.
So you turn all the stuff that you would normally bring out into production stuff. So you start to make your amps smoke. You make your guitars do this. You utilize the stuff that you have to have. You make your microphone do something.
Like Cheap Trick. Cheap Trick turns their cabinets into a bunch of lights.
Yeah, yeah. Or, you know, just anything like that. So that, you know, that's why we were able as an opening act to, like, maybe give a little bit more of a show than your average opener.
So what happened to Flip? It seemed like you had, you know, when I saw you, you had that album out. You were touring with Everclear. It seemed like things were happening. And then all of a sudden,
the record industry died.
Gone.
The record, here's exactly what happened. And it was the day the music died. Frequent to number 38. The follow-up single was a song called I Still Love Rock and Roll, which is a drop-dead crossover.
Awesome hit. Video.
It could be played on a heavy metal station. It could be played in the fucking supermarket, right? It's getting ready to come out, and Danny Goldberg's totally behind the band. It's like, it's us, Warren Zevon, Boston, and the Pretenders on this label. Oh, and yeah. And anyway, where was I going with this? Tom Stoles sues the record label for undue royalties.
Who did? Hey,
Tom Stoles.
Okay.
Who's the guitar player for Boston.
Yep. Boston. And wins. Hires a lawyer, wins, right? Ouch. That's definitely. Chrissy Hynde comes in behind him, does the exact same thing. And of course, he's set precedent. She doesn't even need to hire a lawyer.
Right.
She sues, wins, record company's gone. What year was this? 2000? I don't even know. I mean, I asked that.
2004?
No.
Five.
I was going to say it's got to be early 2000s.
No, it's more like 2000. I'm really bad, so I can't argue it. But it was at the same time, basically, when the music business, by all intent and purpose, took a big hit, you know? I mean, he wasn't the only record label shutting their doors at that time in the record business, that's for sure.
Yeah, they were falling like flies, man.
You have a technical problem, Mike? I'm looking at your eyes.
No. All right, I'm just wikiing this. It closed in April 2006. The label was founded in July of 1999. By Danny Goldberg and Daniel Glass, closed April 2006. The label was later acquired by E1 Entertainment, which, interestingly enough, E1 is who's releasing Ace Frehley's upcoming solo record.
Oh, cool.
Everything kind of comes together, doesn't it?
And
so speaking of Ace, let's talk about that. You toured with him.
I know Ace just had lunch with Eddie Kramer. So that's promising.
Did he? Really?
Yeah.
And here, just so you know, somebody's got to fix this. Flip isn't listed on the Artemis Records wiki page as an act.
Oh. Well, I understand why they're afraid. We were so good that they were afraid people would hurt themselves running to listen to us. So they got to keep it off there for people's own protection.
So wait a second. Is there going to be a Flip reunion at any time?
Never say never, but I don't have anything written down. I mean, I have no idea. Sounds fun. As I start to stutter answering the question, my brain's going, what would it look like?
You know, a one-off show, because it's, you know, there's still stuff that comes through my Facebook friends from Minnesota. Flip pops up every once in a while. Somebody's like, check out this old flyer, check out this old video. And it's interesting that a band that's been gone for so long still has that trickle running. That
they've got loyal followers.
That I would sit here and go, cha-ching, I can make some bucks off of this. Let's put the band back together. Let's do a one-off big show. Sell 2,000 tickets.
As much as I appreciate that, I mean, Flip was like, you know, just like songwriting. I don't like playing songs necessarily from a long time ago. And I know it might not be necessarily good for my career or smart business move or anything, but you know, the Oddfathers for me now and here is so fucking great. God, it's just a real band, and I love it more. And to go back in time and, like, do Flip, it's hard to get my creative, whatever you call it, you know, kick in the ass to do that. I just creatively, it doesn't put gas in my tank. Whereas the Oddfathers right now has totally got me going 24/7.
You could put together a three-band bill, Hairball, yeah, opening for Flip, who opens for the Oddfathers.
Would there be naps in between?
Yes. Yes, there would.
And a coffee machine?
Yes, you'd be set. Okay, well, so there's a couple of things I want to get to before we forget. I want to talk about when you toured with Ace.
Yeah.
Okay, so let's start with that, because I know people are going to say, well, why didn't you ask him about that? So tell us a little bit about what it was like to tour with Ace. When was this? Any funny road stories? Anything you can share?
Yeah. Just for fun tour.
Mm-hmm.
Time I was living in Manhattan. It was managed by David Krebs and Niederlander organization. And we were so excited to do the first show at Hammerjack's with them that we went a little early to watch their sound check.
And what band is this?
Richie Scarlett.
No. What band are you in?
Oh, Rattlin' Bones is the name of the band.
Okay.
Who did a record anyway. And I'm so excited. I'm a big Ace fan and went with Bill Baker.
Sure.
Yep, we know Bill.
Yeah, and me and Bill got to know each other. And we got there, and we were watching Ace sound check. And Ace came out, and they strapped his guitar on him. And he walked towards the front of the stage, and the guitar's just feeding back. Like crazy. And Ace is just walking like he doesn't even hardly hear it. He's got 2 4x12s sitting in front of the drum riser. He sits on one, and he's got a glass of orange juice. And he sits down on one of these amps. He's got his orange juice. His guitar's just squealing. Just feeling it louder than fuck. And he doesn't even know it. And all of a sudden the drummer goes like, whoa, dude. And Ace just stands up. He's like, da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. Starts playing it like absolutely perfect. Like somebody flipped a switch. And they did like Rock It Ride. Do-do-do. Whatever song it was. Rock It Ride. And Ace is just dead on it. And the song is do-do-do. Bam. He sits down on the amp. It was unbelievable. The second show, me and Bill Baker snuck into Ace's dressing room and put on his, he had a pair of KISS boots in there, and we played the smoker and the light up guitar in Ace's dressing room.
Why did Ace have KISS boots?
I don't know. Maybe they weren't KISS boots. Maybe they were. God, I could have swore they were because we were so excited to put them on. I bet I know why. Because he was selling them to somebody in whatever town.
Oh, there you go. You're probably right. He was probably going to autograph and sell them to somebody.
Yeah.
There you go.
Was there a common
I think the better story is Ace had them because Gene and Paul sent them out to him to try him on because they were getting ready for a reunion.
Oh, no, this. Paul and Gene didn't know about the reunion till the unplugged thing. I mean, it's really there. It's really there. The minute they're playing Beth, you literally can see it in Gene's eyes. That is the moment the reunion happened.
Well, Gene looks out
to the crowd like this. That's when it happened.
Wouldn't you say that's when he knew it could happen?
Yes.
Up until then, obviously, there was, let's see if we can make this work. Let's talk. Let's put the pieces in play. But, yeah, you're right. You could see that click and go, all right, this is going to work.
I think it's pretty cool that moment is captured so well, because I really do believe that's the moment. And the camera shot everything. I mean, that's not easy to do. They got it.
Maybe we'll see that moment at the Hall of Fame.
Maybe. It's nice to know they can still give them to us.
The magic. The magic, as everybody says.
It's true.
Okay, so...
I buy into it.
Is there magic in the Oddfathers?
Yes.
God.
There is. Look. Oh,
music magic beyond belief. We show up at rehearsal, and it almost pisses us off because we write a song every freaking... Casey will start playing a riff. We just wrote one yesterday called The Bag I'm In. And about being in a body bag. And
how do you write that from experience?
I didn't. Although I can't. I've come close. But so as far as musical, yeah, you got me. I don't want to get too excited and ramble. But, yeah, there's real chemistry in this band. I've been in bands since 1969. Working real bands, not pretend band. In 1969, I was playing every grade school, middle school, high school in North St. Paul, Maplewood, the area I grew up in, Oakdale, what have you, to right here today, right? That being said, and I've worked with some great people. That being said, the Oddfathers chemistry as far as musicians go is the best I've ever worked with, not even close. It's just a natural flow. We can't even prove. Like I was going to say, we rehearsed the other day and we left looking at each other going, we tried not to write a song.
It's a gift. And I can say from watching this.
It's crazy.
And I can say I've watched the maturation of this whole thing. And it's been exciting to be around and watch. And I got to say, also regarding Casey, Criss, and Tom, the other three that are in the band, all are just the kindest people, just like Brynn. They're just truly nice people. So it's like at the same time, you're also like really happy for them because they're great and they sound good, but they're nice. I mean, that's all part of it. And seeing he's deflecting now, but it's true. And they got something snappy.
Snappy.
Yeah.
There's a review you've never heard before. The Oddfathers. They got something snappy.
Give me something snappy. Then the B-side. You can write a song for the B-side.
But none of that lovers meant crap.
All the songs on the Playtone Galaxy.
I got it. My first exposure to the Oddfathers was when they released their first release. And this, I thought, was so freaking cool how they did this.
Tell me, I can't stand it. What happened?
The double 45 album that you released.
It being 245s?
245s in a gatefold. I was like, this. I love the imagination, the creativity, the balls of a band that the first songs you're going to release, you don't release them digitally on iTunes. You don't sell a CD. It's like you're buying 45s. In a double gatefold.
I think it
opened up glossy. It was just like really impressive.
That's nice to hear. I wanted to make sure that even though we had only been a band for 6 months when we made that, and it's totally live in the studio, we did 30 songs in 4 hours or no, not 30 songs. How many songs did we do, Rob? We did them here. Remember that first live thing? 15 songs in like 3-4 hours. We set up monitors here and everything. And I wanted to make sure that when the band came out right away, it was serious. You know, it's like anybody can throw an MP3 out there. You know, it's like, hey, look, you know, I kind of mean this. You know what I mean?
Of course, the problem was I had no way to get that music onto my iPhone.
Well, that's where we come back. I also sell record players.
Well, and
now we're talking about where it goes.
That's part of the genius of the band, too, because I want to talk about producers. So before we talk about producers, tell everybody the story of how you captured the attention of, and I know you've known these guys, so part of it is history, but how did you capture the attention of Eddie Kramer and also Jack Douglas? Because both of those guys were working with the Oddfathers. So tell that story, because I just think it's a fantastic story.
Well, first of all, you'll be able to watch me Nick fit while I do this because I can't smoke right now in the control room. Let's see. One day at rehearsal, Oddfathers rehearsal, I had a little 70s desktop recorder, you know, 2-button record thing, and recorded rehearsal. Listened to it a lot in my car driving around, and I just was like, God, this is a sound I just don't hear anymore. Just like good. The songs were great. But there was a sound to the cassette player that was just crappy, but in a good way. You know, it was like good crap. Those things have built-in limiters on them and stuff, so when the band plays, it kind of, levels up the sound, and when you talk in between, it gets a little louder, and there's just a sound to it. And I'm thinking, God, I'll bet this is exactly like the tapes producers used to get in the 70s. This is exactly what their demo tapes must have sounded like. Then I thought, oh, let's send some cassettes out. No, they're not going to have cassette. Let's send out cassette players too. So I made dubs too. And then the idea was to work with five. We were going to do originally 5 songs, each one with a different producer. I sent out 5 or 6 cassette decks, one to Bob Ezrin, one to Jack Douglas, one to Eddie Kramer. God, I hope I remember all these names. One to Andy Johns, and one to, maybe that's
Todd
it.
Todd Rundgren?
Yeah, and Todd Rundgren. No. Yeah, maybe. No. I heard back from every one of them. Bob Ezrin said it was too old-fashioned.
Said, this sounds like crap. Why'd you send me a cassette tape?
No, he said it was too old-fashioned, which I found very hilarious because this is the Oddfathers, the world's oldest new band, right? It's like, that's the idea. Mr. Concept Record here isn't getting the concept. You know? And literally within a week, though, he sent me my cassette player back, so I still have it. Jack called me a week later. Andy Johns
was
called me back. Everybody, they wanted to do it immediately.
But tell the story about Jack Douglas opening.
So we started doing the 5 song thing or whatever. At that point, I think we might have decided. Oh, Ted Templeman was the other producer. Decided to cut it down to just Jack and Eddie because it just became too much work to schedule and everything. And Eddie came in and we did some songs with him, went out in L.A., mixed them. Jack came in, we did some songs with him, and it just went like perfectly.
Well,
with Jack.
Worked.
It was literally like I didn't try to set up producer Survivor Island, but it's kind of what it turned into. And Jack, I mean, that's just a joke.
So Brynn, how did their work compare to the other producer you worked with, Tommy Summers?
Similar.
How does Eddie Kramer stack up to Tommy Summers?
Oh, Tommy and Eddie, totally different. Tommy and Jack Douglas, on the other hand, very similar. It's about just like I said with Bill Aucoin, encouragement, positive reinforcement, not being a dark cloud in the room while you're doing it, adding a little sunshine to the moment when you're working on it, adding a little energy. That's what producing and managing really is, guys. There's really no magic wand here. It's the exact same thing that makes your family happy when you're sitting around the dinner table having lunch and all of a sudden you talk and you do something funny and the room lifts up. That's what good music management is.
That's what Tommy did, without question. Tommy brought a little sunshine into the studio.
Sunshine day. Sunshine day. Well, and honestly, too, Brynn has even said this public, I believe, that he felt, and the rest of the guys in the band, I believe, agreed, that them recording Let Me Go Rock and Roll was the catalyst for them finding their sound for the band.
They said that to make you feel happy, because their job is to put a little sunshine back up the producer's butt.
Well, we did the first record live. I missed it. Shit.
He's just giving me crap. But wait a second, though. Before I forget, I just want you to finish the story. I want you to tell people what happened when Jack Douglas got his recorder. Where was he? What was he doing?
Oh, of course. I get it. You're setting me up. He was in doing a record with Aerosmith, and the cassette player came in and all the guys in Aerosmith just loved it and just like freaked on it and were listening to it and passing it around and told Jack that if he didn't work on this, you know, they had never work with him again and shit. And they just thought it was the coolest thing ever. This guy sent you a fucking cassette player? Who is this guy? You work with that guy.
Why doesn't Aerosmith take you on tour?
We were going to be doing synchronized watches.
Can't synchronize, it's digital.
I wouldn't, you know. There's a possibility for shows. I don't want to say we might be doing some, and you know,
yeah,
there's been plenty of talk that.
Okay, so then because the album is
Getting started, I'm not 100% sure the Oddfathers are, you know, we're totally ready for that, but
yeah, you are. Give me a break, you're totally ready for that. So,
a little sunshine from Tommy right there.
Yes, it's producing. That's what it is.
The important thing to know is
a musician or artist's brain, whichever side it is that he works from, right, left brain, the artist side, is almost always insecure. One of the greatest things a manager can do is to work almost like a therapist with that insecurity to that artist and help guide him emotionally into what is cool. Bill Aucoin, 101. That's what he did. He was a genius.
Well, I watched The Oddfathers. I've seen them many, many times. I watched them open up for Steel Panther at First Avenue, which, yeah. A big room, lots of people. And The Oddfathers by the second song, and these people didn't know them. Brynn had them. So they are ready for that. So, like it or not, you're ready for that. But I want to talk about, because I've learned a lot from Brynn too, because we've talked so much about music. And as a casual fan, there's so many things that he shared with me that are so interesting that I think a lot of our listeners would be interested in as well. So can you touch on what a producer's job is for a band, other than the sunshine stuff? Because I listened to your demos, and then I listened to what Jack Douglas did after it was finished. We did that AB that day, and it's incredible. And I want some of the listeners to get a feel for why maybe Hotter Than Hell sounds like this, and you know, Destroyer sounds like that, and Rock and Roll Over is like this. What elements or what did they do for the band?
They pick usually the studio, which has a large impact on the sound. They pick the engineers, the audio engineers. That has a very large impact on the sound. Some producers like Eddie Kramer, engineer as well. They really like to work on placing the microphones and working with how much compression and saturation and you want on any particular thing that a microphone is on, right? And then you got Jack who can engineer but prefers not to clutter his brain with that information, right? And concentrate more on just the sonics of the whole thing and to make sure that the band is out there performing at their best. ultimately the producer's a number one job if he's working with a real band, right? All these situations can change. It's a different situation if you're working with, you know, some pop singer, where if you're working with a real rock band that plays as a band, the best thing you can do is make them feel comfortable and you know, not second guessing themselves at all. So it just comes out really naturally. Sonic differences. Now, for instance, I know Bob Ezrin prints his effects to tape. Like, if you decide you want to put reverb or echo on a lead vocal, I usually do that with a piece of outboard gear. Bob Ezrin will print that. So, like, if you listen to the Destroyer remixes, all the vocal effects and stuff, they're all exactly the same as they were way back when. You can't take them off because he printed them to tape that way. So there's producers that do that. And another big thing with the producer is keeping up with equipment, you know. Equipment has a big part to do with it. Make sure all the gear in the studio is all working.
So when you worked with Eddie Kramer, I'm putting myself back into the geeky KISS fan here. Did you talk about KISS with him? Did you talk about any of his production work? Did you talk about Ace? I mean, what were some of the minutia moments that you had with Eddie Kramer?
Nothing that would like blow your socks off. But anytime, I mean, I'm a fanboy, so anytime that somebody's worked with Ace or a KISS guy or Richie Blackmore, for that matter, I'll ask him questions about it.
Did he give you something that you didn't know? I mean, with all of your time in the industry and all of the years you've spent with Bill, did Eddie say something where you're like, really? I didn't know that, or that's cool, or that was amazing?
Nope.
Damn, the show sucks.
Maybe it's the questions. Okay, so then going back to producers, I'd like to know,
I could answer that in a vague way. In kind of a way, I think it's about perception, really. You got to understand that, once again, with Eddie Kramer, this is something he does every day of his life. You know, it's hard for him to pinpoint minutiae, although he certainly has his moments. He really likes cooking and photography. I'm trying to think. He just said how skinny Ace was. And that he thinks Ace is an underappreciated guitar player, just as simply as a guitar player thinks he's great. But it's just the show sucks.
Make something up to make this good.
Okay, well, I'll take it another direction. Talking about producers, do you think that in your opinion, the last two KISS albums could have been better if they had hired a producer versus Paul doing it himself?
I don't know. Don't know. We have no. How do we know that?
Because
how would we know that?
We're a bunch of geeky KISS fans that are
just
filled
guessing
with what we know is
okay,
right.
We're guessing. If I were to have produced it, it would have been way better.
Yeah, thank you.
That's what we want to hear.
Yeah. I'm not trying to paint you into a corner. I'm just trying to, you know, because there's always been that argument.
All right, let me rephrase it. As somebody who's been in many bands, done many recordings, worked with many producers, do you feel like bands can produce themselves, or do bands really need to have a producer?
Once again, there's no blanket answer to any of these. It's different in all situations. That being said, Johnny Cash had a producer to the end, and you don't get any better than that, do you? It's like, I think ultimately the right producer, you're always better off with a producer, because a good producer knows when to do nothing. I remember the first time Mick Ronson recorded my guitar, and I was like all upset, and I'm like, you didn't even say nothing. What, you know, and this is my first big time in a studio with the big guy, you know, and he's like, sometimes you got to know when just to do nothing. So that's a big part of the producers.
Okay. Who would you, KISS goes to record a new album, who would you love to see them work with as a producer? Who would be an interesting producer?
God, I'd like to know, what's Ted Templeman up to? I'd like to hear his his version of Kiss, because it's just a big loud thing, you know, with him. Jack would be awesome. Kiss. Jack never did a Kiss album, but Jack doesn't, you know. When we were in the studio,
did he say why?
Jack's a member. Jack's a member of the voting posse of the Hall of Fame. And while we were in the studio, he got the contact that he had to either vote for Kiss or LL Cool J. And he knew I was a big Kiss fan, so he went Kiss, even though Jack isn't necessarily a big Kiss fan. So when Kiss got into the Hall of Fame, Jack called me that morning. He said, "You better be fucking happy. I put him in the Hall of Fame for you." I said, "Yeah, yeah,
I agree, though.
The next record."
Well, he would be, because, you know, isn't he doing the next Cheap Trick album? So, yeah, he'd be great. I'd love to see him do a Kiss record.
And he seems the 170s guy who didn't do, you know, seems perfect. But I don't, Jack wouldn't be interested, to be honest.
It's not his thing? No.
He likes working with the Oddfathers, I know that.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You guys have that thing. Something snappy, you know?
So you, Brynn, as a Kiss fan, what was your first Kiss concert? What was your first album?
Nice. First album was the first album before it was in the stores through Columbia House Records. They used to do advance releases on Columbia House. They could get them into Columbia House before they could get them to the record stores.
Like how far in advance?
I want to say I got Kiss 1 a week before it hit the stores. Based on the cover.
Now, I was just going to say, did you know to get it, or was it, was just the cover, you saw the cover and go, I got to just see what this is.
Yep.
And how old were you?
I don't know. What year was that? 73? That's awful, it's awfully close to math. So I don't know.
That's your manager's job.
Well, my brain doesn't like that side.
So what was your first impression then when you dropped the needle on that first Kiss record? What happened to you?
Freaking loved it.
What were you listening to outside of that?
Johnny Cash, the Everly Brothers, Three Dog Night. What else did I have? Deep Purple, Black Sabbath, The Monkees.
Okay.
Now what? Was I answering a question?
You know, he's asking you when was the first time you saw him.
Oh, then the first time I saw him was Civic Center Theater in St. Paul. I want to say, once again, 75. It was like... It
had to be 75.
It was 75.
2 weeks before or after Alive had just come out, and they did two shows. One at 7:30 and one at midnight, I think. And I saw the first show from like fifth row right on the aisle. It was great. Point Blank opened up.
Oh.
Nicole.
Nicole. I love that song.
Yeah.
Cool.
So
what else?
After that, how many other, have you seen like every tour since then? Are you that type of a fan or?
No. I certainly was up until Love Gun came out, and I kind of got bummed out on Love Gun.
Why?
That was because it was just too lightweight. Sounded too lightweight to me. Wasn't aggressive enough. But so I saw them every tour up until, and I did see the Love Gun tour, and then I was done. Although I did see, what was the one where the Statue of Liberty exploded at the end?
Revenge.
I saw that tour. Yeah. And then I saw the first reunion tour, and then I saw the just pitiful Psycho Circus tour. Oh, that is beyond Spinal Tap. I would have loved to have been in the room when somebody offered the idea of a 3D concert. It's like, I don't know if you guys know this or not, you're already in 3D. It's live. The idea
time to put your glasses on.
Something that's not live, appear live. Not to tell you something that's live. That always,
you know, that tour just had the effects were wrong. The band was already starting to really internally fall apart at that time.
The back line looked like shit. The amp line looked like shit.
Yeah, you know, and band members were really starting to look lazy and overweight. And
Ace looked like,
like the Michelin Man.
Yeah,
I'm gonna take like shit Ace for that, aren't I? Are
like Ace is gonna take the pillow out.
Oh, Lord.
Oh, God. Oh, yeah, as that's Ace coming out of my mouth, I'm going to freaking get roasted.
You're going to get reamed for that. As you should. Okay, so what else? Do we have anything else we want to...
Ace is going to take the pillow out, and then it ruins the magic.
So what was your feelings about KISS when they took the makeup off?
First thing I said it to my little brother. I said, it's genius. Now they can put it back on. That was my first thought. Yep.
Yeah,
I like Lick It Up. I like the album Lick It Up, though. Let's let the... Yeah.
Where they went in the 80s, though, visually and musically, what do you think? Nothing for you.
You can hear me, right?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Yeah.
Such a huge fan of Bon Jovi, it's...
I was pleased to hear Revenge. I thought that kicked ass. But
yeah,
like Rock and Roll Crazy Nights, I mean, you guys, I mean, that makes the Bay City Rollers sound like Dylan.
But I love Crazy Nights, and there's nothing wrong with the Bay City Rollers.
No, I mean, I like a Twinkie once in a while too.
Tommy, do we ask him the one big question we always try to ask people?
Yeah, I think because we haven't asked anyone this in quite some time. Because it goes by weight.
We measure in weight, not inches.
All right. So.
Yeah, because we haven't asked anyone this in a while. So go ahead.
Did Vinnie Vincent save KISS?
On some level, yes. But. There was
a
KISS.
At what level? How?
What level?
Vinny was the absolute musically and artistically the right guy at the right time. They needed certainly somebody. Filling Ace Frehley's shoes is no easy task, and I think Vinny did a great job
of
doing
it. But you know, musically, Creatures of the Night, that direction and sound was set before Vinny became part of the band. Now, Lick It Up, sure. I mean, he was in the band. He was in the studio. He recorded. He wrote. But okay. A lot of Creatures of the Night, other people played guitars. He didn't write on every song. You know, according to Chris Lent, that direction was set. That direction had to happen for KISS to...
I wonder how they got... Well, I've heard the stories of how they got Vinnie Vincent, but I'd also be curious to find out how much the record company was behind Vinnie Vincent. Like, if they were very supportive and really liked Vinnie because of his songwriting and everything out of the get-go, and therefore on a business level, it's very possible that if the record label had a lot of faith in Vinnie Vincent, that he saved KISS.
That's an interesting theory.
I mean, I don't know that that's the case, but I know that that can be a case.
You know, I think the record label basically, my takeaway from when we talked to Chris Lent was, before Creatures of the Night happened, the record label basically said, you got to do this, you got to get back to what KISS is. It's got to be a heavy record. It's got to be metal. It's got to be KISS. None of this pop, none of this concept album, none of this disco stuff. That's over. It's, you know, it's this or... we're done. So when KISS delivered it, I'm sure the label just said, great, you delivered what we need. This is a killer album. We don't care who did it. You did it. It's kind of what my takeaway was.
Yeah, I believe it.
Now, you know, again, is it all...
So did save KISS? Well, every member who comes into the band kind of saves KISS a little bit because they needed that, you know?
I mean, quite honestly, I would argue that taking the makeup off saved KISS more than anything else.
If it's a contest, no question, taking the makeup off saved Kiss more than Vinny did.
Yeah.
No question. I should say I would agree completely with that.
I mean, it gave him a little bit of lifeblood all of a sudden, because I keep telling the same story, you know, how Creatures of the Night comes out and I'm calling KQ to request Kiss, and the DJs are always saying Kiss can't play. They wear makeup. They suck. Lick It Up comes out and I call and request Lick It Up, and they're like, that's the greatest song in the world. These guys are great. They took the makeup off.
Isn't that funny? I mean, it's the same argument, Michael. Isn't that same argument, you guys, we had in fifth grade with people?
Yeah.
I remember telling people that, so you're telling me if Jimi Hendrix changed his shirt, it would sound different?
Right.
Is that what you're telling me? You know, I don't get it. And it's like, I can put Kiss up against Humble Pie. I can put on my playlist of Humble Pie, Slade, Kiss, Alex Harvey, Alice Cooper, and all those bands that I love, and Kiss is right up there.
And it was just
totally hold their own with the music. To me, that's just all a bunch of hogwash.
To me, it was funny because Creatures of the Night and Lick It Up are very complimentary albums.
Absolutely,
they're both loud, heavy. They're rock records. So to say that one is better than the other didn't make sense just because the makeup came off. It's not like you were comparing Creatures of the Night to Unmasked.
Right. No, they might be their back-to-back most unified records ever. Creatures of the Night and Lick It Up might be, I mean, and everything. But I miss the days when, you know, the recording technology was newer and the place you recorded and the people you did it with made more of a difference than it does today when records would come out. You didn't know what they were going to sound like. You know, you just, God, I wonder. And every Kiss record sounded so different from the next one.
Well,
and
those two albums, to me, have the person I would, as a Kiss fan, love to hear from, and I don't think we ever will, Michael James Jackson. He was the common denominator between those two albums.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, I feel like he's probably more important than even Vinny was. I mean, here's the producer. He's the producer.
But didn't he have something to do with bringing Vinny in?
There's different stories of who brought Vinny in. Adam Mitchell claims he introduced Vinny to Gene and
Gene.
Paul because he was doing songwriting. And who knows the real story? But, you know, listen, and at the same time, I could also argue that if one person, first of all, I don't think one person could ever save the band because there's too many. Listen, you're in a band. There's too many other factors that play into everything that goes on that you can't.
There's
just
anybody
say,
that any ever right. If there's anybody that's ever saved Kiss, it's Paul Stanley.
Paul Stanley,
it's freaking down.
Because
that's the only guy.
During the '80s, it was completely up to him to say, "I'm done with this band because Gene has checked out. I'm going off to become Paul Stanley solo." He kept the band going.
No question.
He's the mute. Ace is the rock star, no questions about that, but Paul is the creative artist musically. He cares he cares about the music, the songs. So he's, you know, the only reason we got Sonic Boom and Monsters because Paul wanted to go back to the studio and record.
Right.
You know, given that he produced both the last two, right?
Yep.
Or was it just a,
yeah.
Both
yeah.
Of them.
I mean, if you would have asked me before those records came out who should produce a Kiss record, my answer would be Paul.
Of Kiss members,
now it might
definitely.
Not be, but at that time, that's what I would have said.
You know, I definitely would take Paul over anybody else in Kiss to self-produce. I just feel like Paul's too close to it.
Well, yeah, and sometimes you need that outside person to bring in the ideas to bring the best out of people, at least from my perspective. That's why, you know, I think certain producers, when you look at the body of work that they've done with different artists, some of them are really strong consistently because they have that ability, like Bryn was saying, to encourage and prop up and all of that to get the best out of that artist and not try and change them.
Did you ever talk to Eddie about would he ever want to produce Kiss again?
Oh, he would in a heartbeat. Yeah, he loves all the Kiss
even
stuff.
Without Ace?
I did talk to Eddie about something cool with Kiss. When they did Kiss Alive, the live crowd loop, you know?
right.
was so long, and they didn't want it. They wanted to make sure you didn't hear repeat screams and things from people, something that would stand out that you go, oh, I just heard that three songs ago, that the tape loop went through the whole perimeter on the inside of all the walls of the whole studio off a two-inch tape machine, not unlike that guy right there, using mic stands as capstans. So wherever the tape would go around these corners, there were just mic stands set up all around. And he told me about that. And the truth was that I had already been made aware of that. Bill Aucoin told me that. So yeah, there's some minutia that they both told me. See, I need a memory spring to realize what's...
That's what we brought you on this show for. And listen, if you can't give us more of that, you ain't coming back.
Not a problem. It'll come to me once in a while. What can I tell you?
I'm going to have to start just writing stuff down and go, hey, remember?
You got to when you hang out with Brynn, when he calls you at 6:30 in the morning, you just got to hit a recorder and record everything that happens. So he doesn't.
That would incriminate both of us.
Yeah, it really would. No way.
Actually, we don't talk about. Well, we do talk about music a lot, but other stuff as well. But yeah,
you talk about better bands like Cheap Trick, right?
Oh, I love Cheap Trick. God,
talk about the Hall of Fame. Talk about a band that should be making the kind of money Aerosmith is making, a band that's making the kind of money. Aerosmith is still totally and completely a real band. They're the real deal.
I was never an Aerosmith fan. Sorry. It just does nothing for me.
Get Your Wings is one of my all-time favorites.
Now, Cheap Trick, I have to say Cheap Trick has moved above Kiss as my favorite.
I love them. I mean, they're absolutely wonderful.
And they're a band that, in my mind, do it because they love freaking doing it. Because when you see Cheap Trick
they can't do anything else at this point either, really. But they still do it.
And, you know, because when you see when I saw Cheap Trick, like, opening for Poison and Def Leppard, I'm like... That is just, it's a heartbreak for me, and it's got to be a heartbreak for them, but they love playing music, that they'll still do it. They'll go in and play a club to 200 people if that's all they can do, because they love playing music.
Yep. Yeah. Yeah, I had the thrill of touring with them with Cheap Trick for quite some time. I know all those guys well.
Flip or who?
Yeah, Flip did, toured with them quite a bit. Shared producers. I just sent them guys some songs, too. Through Jack.
Did you send them Freak?
No. And this came through their producers, Julian Raymond and Jack's working with them. They're both working with them now. Not to miss Minutia. I don't know. You want to know what I was doing earlier today? Yeah. I'm mixing a song with me and Mike McCready from Pearl Jam and Brad Sinsel, one of the world's greatest singers of all time.
Is it a Kiss song?
No, it's an original song.
We don't care.
He called me up one morning. He's like, hey, man, you want to drive to Rick Nielsen's house with me? I got nothing else to do. It's like, really? He's like, yeah, yeah, you did.
That would have been fun.
I know. You wanted to road trip because you thought you had to write.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, that's right.
You're kidding me. So, well, what else? So, were you touching on anything else, Mikey?
I'm going to share a really great Bill Aucoin story with you, if I may.
Please.
That's what we had you here for. Jesus.
Well, it's really about, you know, producing is a lot like interviewing. It's about getting people to do the things that you want to do and doing it in a fashion that they're comfortable doing it in.
You're like the band that goes into studio to record with no pre-production. And we spend the first 3 weeks just going, what are you going to play?
Not really. No, I'm more kind of the guy who comes in and writes five songs in the first 5 minutes and says, what do you want to do now?
I'm throwing your songs out. Trash those songs. Let's do it again.
Okay. All right. So tell us your story.
Bill Aucoin comes to town because Cherry Forever, the original bass player for Flip, also the bass player in Obsession, Rattlin' Bones, Funhouse.
Was that his birth name?
I love him. Cherry Forever?
Yeah.
No, his birth name is Greg Item. Okay. And it's hard, let's face it, it's hard to say take it, Greg. Anyway, So when Freaky Useless, not his real name either, Randy Ingebrigtsen, you can't, it's hard to say, take it, Randy. So Freaky, anyway, joined the band. Bill came to town to meet him, and we went out to this place to eat. And I remember as we're walking there, Randy, Freaky, just being like, looking at me and going, Brynn, this is the greatest day of my life. Thank you so much. I can't believe I'm going out to eat dinner with Bill Aucoin. And I just said, just wait. And I looked at him, kind of laughed. And we had our dinner and everything, and all of a sudden Bill starts ordering shots of Jägermeister, right? No problem. We each pop a shot. About 5 minutes later, he orders another round. Oh, all right. We do another one. And literally, immediately, why don't you just bring us another round? I go to my road manager, Sean, and I say, Sean, go find the waitress and tell her to start filling ours up with Coke. Coca-Cola, but to still keep giving Bill Jägermeister, because I can't keep up. And so we're drinking these shots of Coca-Cola and like going, pretending like, and Bill just got hammered. And on his way home, he hit a light pole, and he ran into a light pole, he had a big sore on his forehead.
Walking?
Yeah, okay. Roman will remember this. And I saw him the next morning. God, I forget exactly how it played out, what we did the next day or whatever, what work we were doing. But he sent me a letter again like a week later with a drawing of himself on it. And he had drawn a little blood mark and his head hit in his forehead. It was funny.
So Brynn, what is the one most important business lesson, if you could say, that you took away from working with Bill all these years?
Your talent is smarter than you are. If you're truly talented, it's smarter than you. Learn to listen and let it tell you things. Don't try to control it and tell it what to do.
Wow, that's deep.
Yeah, that's interesting. Makes sense, though.
Because you know? As you're saying that, I'm like, the geek in me, KISS geek, is like, all right, how does that apply to KISS? How did Bill apply that lesson to KISS?
You know,
that's how I'm trying to relate.
Right. Very easily. I mean, can you imagine the amount of crap those guys took? You know, Bill's also the main guy who's responsible for KISS keeping their makeup on when Neil Bogart wanted to take it off. I mean, I know KISS takes a lot of credit, the band members do, for that, which I'm sure they deserve, but Bill was right there too, saying, no way. You know, Bill's really a fighter for the creative. Just like Roman said, he said it perfectly. It's magic to watch Bill when he grabs onto something that he likes and turn it into something. He just knows how to frickin' do it.
Did Bill ever talk to you about the separation with KISS? How it ended? How he felt about it?
I got to think about this a little bit, because yes. And he puts it very simply, that it just made sense and it just came to an end. We were doing different things. I was starting to work with more acts, stars, and you know, the like, and getting interested in chefs, in managing chefs.
So from your take, it sounded like Bill felt like it was kind of a mutually, time was right. It wasn't one or the other, because when, I don't know if you listened to the episode where we had Russ Delaney on, Sean's nephew.
Yeah, I did.
But a couple times, Russ was very clear in saying, Bill told me he sold KISS.
Bill told me he sold KISS.
Yes.
Bill sold out his rights, his portion of the rights, you mean, to
the
band?
Yeah, well, he didn't know any more than that's what Bill would say to him. We could assume that meant Bill was saying, you know, I sold my rights of KISS off, because, and even Russ alluded to, Bill was saying, listen, after going through Dynasty and all of that, that was not what KISS was. It was over for him, and he sold KISS.
Well, I can tell you this much, Bill wouldn't, Bill wouldn't take $1 million to do something he didn't artistically believe in. I'll tell you that much. Bill is not a money over matter guy. He'll take the matter over the money any time, and he firmly believes that the matter is what brings the money. And if it doesn't, it ain't worth having. He was really cool that way.
So you believe that it was just the end of the road between Kiss and Bill, that it wasn't what it was in 74, 75, 76, that the band had changed, Bill was going differently, they kind of went their own ways.
He did mention certainly that the band began to, with all the Yes people around him and stuff, begin to think that they could do more things on their own than they could really do. And it becomes a delicate situation, you know, when you're the manager of the group and you got to maybe tell them, you know, that they can't do things that they think they can do. It's kind of counterproductive, you know what I mean? It would be a tough thing to do.
But doesn't that go back to the whole...
the boat moving forward without... while trying to stop it once in a while. Yeah, I don't know.
But doesn't that go back to the simple idea of the production? Sometimes they think they can do more than they can really do.
Yeah. Yep.
You know, I just think you need a whole... I don't know, from my perspective, it seems like you need a team of people to help you. People you can trust.
Well, my thing, and as far as producing goes, it's a little different because it's an audio thing. And as we all know, even just putting a simple message on our phones that we can live with is hard enough to do, let alone record songs. So you really need, you know, you need your wife to walk in and go, no, you sound totally normal and fine.
Now, here's another one. Did Bill ever mention anything to you about his feelings of Kiss taking the makeup off? Did he say it was a mistake?
Yep. He understood it, but yeah, he liked him better with it. It's that simple. He didn't pontificate nearly, you know, as much as like we do. I remember one night staying at his house in Hollywood, Florida, when I was making the Flip Blow It Out Your Ass record there, and I took him on in Kiss Trivia.
Yeah.
Kicked his freaking ass. Online Kiss Trivia, I kicked his fucking ass. I couldn't even believe how bad he was. It was awesome. And that was where I learned mostly that it was all business. He knew the business side, not so much the musical side. Give me a minute to explain it to the guy in Alabama, okay? It's going to take two. First, I'm going to do this just to get him comfortable. And then the second thing I'll say is, what? I'm pretty sure you'll understand exactly what it is I'm talking about.
Oh, Lord.
We should have Brynn as the third side of the coin all the time.
I know.
I can't do that. I love the show, though. I love Mitch. You guys, I told Tommy, outside, you guys have learned so much by doing this show on what it's really like being a band. And if you could walk away from it today and look at it a year, you know, back, if you could have some hindsight, you'll be able to compare what's going on with you guys and Mitch almost identical to a band. Almost identical. The only problem is, well, how long did you guys last with Mitch? Now, you had been doing Drop the Needle with him before this, right?
Yeah. So, well, we did, 65 or 66 episodes with Mitch?
How many years of grief did he give you? Personal grief. I don't mean that in a mean way.
There was no personal grief.
Oh, okay. Okay.
It was a difference of direction.
Gotcha. Well, then you're not like a band. Then you guys are like for real human beings. A band would be it'd be neurotic. But you got to remember.
But then again, see, the three of us have never been in the same room, so who knows?
I know, that's wild.
If we would have recorded this in the same room for 66 weeks, there might have been some beer bottles thrown.
It could have went either way, I suppose. But absolutely, when you have imagine what it's like to cruise in a little car with somebody for years, trying to make it, scrapping. You know, like you've heard the stories. I think it's in the one Kiss book where they're playing in San Francisco and they're eating hot dogs and shit.
Yeah,
for that San Francisco show. I mean, imagine that, to be that broke and to be that hard up. and to not like the people you're hanging out with to go play music for 90 minutes.
And maybe that explains all of the tension at the Hall of Fame.
It's hard to do. All I know is it's hard to do. It really does take an effort.
Yeah, I can't even imagine. Some of the stories you've told me.
Yeah, so, and that's, no, you know, we're lucky Bill managed to keep them together as long as he did.
Mm-hmm. Did he ever give you any tips and tricks on how to work out those issues within a band?
By example. Yep, absolutely. He was just a positive energy. Really, this is what, you know, if there was an argument, for instance, within the band, Bill would say something like, really? This is how we're going to spend our time arguing. You know?
He just seemed to know what the right thing was to say.
Yeah. He just knew. He was a good viber. He was a totally good viber. That guy would walk into a room and it was just a funner place to be.
I know. I wish I would have had the chance to meet him. Sounds like an incredible person.
I met him only once, real, real briefly, in a bar after a KISS convention.
I traveled with him for years. We traveled together. And I remember we went to, he was a guest speaker at his KISS convention once while Flip was on tour. And we stopped and we went to it. He wasn't with us on tour, but we stopped on the way and watched the convention. And there was a guy we nicknamed Duct Tape Gene. Yeah. Oh, so bad and sad and awesome and pitiful all at the same time. This guy had a Gene costume made completely out of duct tape. So fucking painful. And your mind's up. You know what this guy looks like. He's 200 pounds overweight. He's got long black curly hair, and you wonder if it's grease or Jerry Curl in his hair. And why would he be wearing Jerry Curl? He's a white guy. So it's grease. And the duct tape Gene is really, really greasy. And he comes over to meet Bill, and he's just so happy. Bill's just so nice to him, and it's all we can do from just like dying, you know, laughing and just like going, how do you not say something? And Bill was so nice to this guy, and we couldn't keep a straight face.
Privately, when you were with Bill, like privately out of like the convention where there's a lot of public, would you guys just kind of laugh at KISS fans every once in a while? Go, oh my God, they are just the craziest?
Yeah. Oh yeah. In the same way that you do with Star Trek fans. I mean, there's an element of the KISS fan that is certainly exactly the same makeup as a Star Trek fan, you know? I like how Roman put it. In episode 37, when you were hiding behind that rock, what was that rock made out of? Did you guys have a band meeting for that?
I mean, it's funny because we would get some of those questions about the Roman episode where it's like, that sucked. You know, you should have asked Roman about what did Bill do back in 1974 when this was happening with KISS. And I'm just like, do you realize Roman didn't meet Bill until 1994?
Yeah.
And Roman was not a KISS fan.
I knew Bill longer than Roman. Yeah.
Did Bill ever talk about wanting to manage KISS for the reunion?
Yes. Yep. He would have done it. They talked about it. It was in the possibility.
I mean, like, as in serious discussions were happening with Gene and Paul to do it?
Absolutely. Yep.
Any ideas why? Did it just come down to the better deal with Doc?
No, my guess is it probably came down to with Doc's reputation with the promoters around the country. It was at that time healthier than Bill's in that fashion, where Bill had gone off and done some other things, and Doc was very much of that ilk of that time.
I always contend that reunion really isn't a true reunion without Bill and Sean being part of the original four getting back.
That would have been the best.
That would have been put all the pieces into place.
Oh, there's no question. We would have, if that would have happened, I would venture to guess that we would have saw new effects. It wouldn't have been just they would have come up with new shit. You know, new,
right.
Like Ace's smoking guitar. Yeah, he still would have did the smoking guitar, but he also would have done, you know, something else that was really cool. The creative juices would have been flowing a little stronger, I think, if Bill was in there.
I mean, obviously, this is just your opinion, but do you think they would have come out with new costumes right away, or would they have tried to recreate the classic look like what they did?
I think they would have came out with the classic look out of the gate.
And then evolved.
Yep. Bill would have not allowed Psycho Circus to happen without Peter and Ace.
The recording of the album.
Right. He wouldn't let the band not be the band.
Okay.
Interesting.
But how would he have made it? I mean, this, I don't know, you may probably wouldn't even know. How would he make it happen if those two couldn't perform, couldn't deliver the goods? How would it happen?
He wouldn't. Bill would have left. Said, forget it then.
So I'm out. Go ahead and do it however you want, but I'm not going to.
That's my guess. I mean, we're playing guess, but
sure.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yep.
Speculation's good.
Yep. Okay. I remember where, I forget where we were, but me and Bill were somewhere and it was like a poor town and we were partying with some, you know, people that were having a rough time or however you want to say it. And we had such a fun time that afternoon. I forgot, you know, playing croquet or something. And I remember Bill was just in great spirits. And I remember on the way back, I said, Bill, and I've been with Bill at the most expensive restaurants in the world with, you know, high pollutant people, right? And I'm like, Bill, you really had a good time today, didn't you? And he's like, yeah. I go, you know, as much as I've known, you'd rather hang around with like salt of the earth people than say Donald Trump, wouldn't you? Oh, any day. Bill would way rather hang out with, you know, us.
Right. Yeah.
That tells you a lot about him then, right there.
Yep.
Yep.
He's a people person.
Anything else, Tommy?
We got a ton. Thank you, Brynn. I mean, we got to continue this conversation, but I honestly, we covered the stuff that was coming into my head as I was leading up to this, and I know there's more.
I'm wondering if there's a story that I'm forgetting or not.
Well, if you remember, we'll just, you know, we'll have you join us as a special guest at some point in the future.
Yeah, because this has gone almost 2 hours.
You got a lot to say.
Yeah.
Oh, really?
But I want to also, but before we wrap up, though, I really want to encourage everybody, please go and check out the Flip stuff, like Mike was saying. But also, too, check out the Oddfathers. They're exceptional. And their newest disc, Part 1, just came out. You can get it on iTunes. You can also get it in your local record stores. So check it out, Oddfathers.
Tommy,
the Oddfathers.
Tommy, you are so much like Gene Simmons. You just plug, plug, plug.
Because it's important to me.
Oh, but he does it in such a nice tone. Gene is just like
sunshine coming from Tommy when he does it.
Sunshine in the room, brother.
I like it. You did. I'm telling you, I know you guys both think it's funny that I'm serious about this when he produced that single, because he did. And another thing that producers do is, you know, producers are often liaisons between the record company and the band, like Ron Jensen bringing KISS to, what was it, Epic in the beginning or whatever company it was. I mean, that's a producer's job as well, and I've done that as well with, like, the fuck-ups that I brought to Capitol Records, produced and managed. Anyway, all that kind of stuff. And Tommy did sincerely produce Let Me Go Rock and Roll. Producing, if there's any one job you can take away from producing and still be a good producer, is engineering. It's all the other stuff that matters. So without question, he did. Now, does he know what any of those buttons do?
Nope.
No, but I'm here to give you a little secret. It's not nearly as intimidating as it looks, because each one of these rows is one thing. It's just many, and if you look at this one thing, here's the volume on your stereo. Here's the pan on your stereo. Here's the bass. Here's the mid-range. Here's the treble. Here's the input on your stereo. That's all this board is. It's just 24 of them in a row. So this group of knobs only corresponds to this single fader. And this one is exactly the same as this one, as is this one. So you really only need to learn how to do one thing and then put it across. So I know that board is intimidating to look at, but once you put it in the frame of mind as your stereo receiver, and just imagine 24 stereo receivers lined up in a row and having to run that, it becomes a lot less intimidating. Right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And no, as you're saying all that, I'm sitting here going, I just figured out the name for Tommy's fan base.
What?
The Sunshine Army.
Great. Now Criss is going to make some thing with rainbows and Care Bears.
Tommy's Sunshine Army, because he brings sunshine into your world.
But we don't need a sunshine, and we got the ilk.
It's a sunshine in summer.
Well, listen,
the sun's shining, right, Mr. Summer?
The fans want Tommy to have his own fan base. They really do. And I think this is it, the Sunshine Army.
I think avoiding it is the way to go.
Yeah.
I say play the backseat on this one. Let them want. Uh-huh. Let them want.
Yep. I agree.
Let them have fun with it, Tommy.
Exactly. Because the minute you give it to them, then what have those people got to do? You know?
Apparently nothing.
The only thing they got.
Great.
All right, let's wrap this baby up.
All right.
Okay, I can talk to you guys all day.
Because Brynn needs to have a cigarette.
Yes, and I got to get to an appointment. Yeah, you got to go home and feed the kids dinner tonight.
You know what? I even got up here.
Sounds like the Oddfathers. Bye, Brynn.
Let's wrap this up.
That's another tear goes dry. It's going to be on part two.
There you go. You heard a brand new song.
Yeah. Love it.
All right. Thanks.
Bye, guys. Love you.
This was awesome. Thank you, man.
Rock steady, man.
Okay. Rock steady. Talk to you in the morning, Tommy.
Okay.
That was crazy. That was wild. That was minutia. That was gasm. That was Brynn. That was uncontrollable. Uncontrollable. Yep. If you could stick through the whole thing, I think you got some very cool tidbits about Bill and Eddie Kramer and Ace Frehley and God knows what else. So,
well, and that's how Brynn is all the time. That wasn't an act. That's how he is.
Yes.
You know, so imagine sitting at your office desk at 7:30 in the morning after three cups of coffee, he calls.
So we got to give people some homework.
Okay.
I don't know.
We talked about so much stuff. It's like, how do you even pick, you know?
What do you think of Brynn?
Yes. Could he be the third host?
What do you think of Brynn and his...
Yeah, do you want him to come on again?
Everywhere.
Yeah.
Uncontrollable. Crazy.
He's a rock star.
He's a rock star. Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Got a lot to say.
Yeah.
You thought keeping Russ Delaney... on track was difficult.
Yeah.
Please.
Yeah, the way.
Nothing compared to Brynn.
No.
All right. Yeah. Leave us whatever you want to say about Brynn.
Because we just don't know what to do.
We don't know what to do.
Yeah.
Facebook/3sidesofthecoin, 3sidesofthecoin.com, 3sidesofthecoin.youtube.com. I do think you need to talk to Brynn and get some of the Rocksteady t-shirts and see if we can sell them in our store.
Okay.
We can make that happen for them. That would be cool.
Oh, yeah.
I'd love to buy one. I'm sure a few other fans would. Would you? Hey, there you go. There's another question. Do you guys want to buy a Rocksteady t-shirt?
Yeah, because Brynn owns... See, we didn't we didn't talk about that, but Brynn owns that now.
He owns a trademark.
Yep, he got that from Bill, and that is his record label, Rocksteady Records.
So I think that would be a cool t-shirt. Would you guys be interested in it? Let us know.
Yeah, sounds good.
All right, until next week when we will talk about the Hall of Fame.
Yeah, we'll recover.
Later.
Bye.
Bye.